I came to this issue as someone who had a pretty unforgettable and irreconcilable experience last year. Within a 48-hour time period, I went from working with an internally displaced population in rural Sudan to week one of Harvard Law School. The contrast was, quite frankly, obscene, and I really didn't know what to do. My first instinct was to jump on a plane straight back to Sudan. The alternative, of course, was to stay here and work with the resources at hand. And for better or worse, that's what I did. I co-founded an organization called the Harvard Darfur Action Group. When we started, there were three of us, and we were committed to mobilizing this campus on the issue of Darfur. What we were facing was the fact that most of our classmates didn't even know that Sudan was a country, let alone knew why we were going on about this place called Darfur. And this was in spite of the fact that just 2 months earlier, the then Secretary of State, Colin Powell, had declared the situation in Darfur to be genocide. It did my head in to think that I was here on what is one of the most prestigious academic institutions on the planet, and people could be so out of touch with the reality. We piled hours and hours of our time into awareness raising. We brought in speakers, we held vigils, we screened documentaries, we wrote op-eds, and just were generally trying to make the situation in Darfur tangible to the students here in Cambridge. Fast forward to 6 months down the track, and the level of awareness about Darfur on the campus was quite transformed from what it was when I first got back from Sudan. But what we were facing was a new challenge. Suddenly, we had all these students who knew about Darfur, who cared, who were turning around to us and saying, "So what can I do?" And we realized that getting people to care about genocide is actually the easy part. The difficult part is directing them what to do with that care after they've made that discovery. Raphael Lemkin had posed the question, if women, children, and old people were to be murdered 100 miles from here, wouldn't you run to help? Then why do you stop this decision of your heart when the distance is 3,000 miles instead of 100? I think that part of the answer is that we know how to run. We know how to help someone who is 100 miles away from us. We're not very good at working out how to help people that are on the other side of the globe. One of the answers that we came up with was in the form of a divestment campaign. And there's a very nice story that you can tell about divestment. Basically, it costs money to wage a genocidal campaign. And in Darfur, the government of Sudan is getting that money from the companies that do business with us. Therefore, if you can cut that train of funding out, then you can stop the genocide continuing. Students understood that logic and really got behind this divestment campaign that led in April this year to a quite historic decision by the Harvard Corporation to divest itself on purely moral grounds of the $4.4 million that it had in PetroChina. This attracted... It attracted international publicity. Other universities have followed suit, and states are looking at doing this in terms of their state pension funds. So that was one answer to the question. The other answer was fundraising directly for the African Union forces, who were and still are the only people who are standing between civilians and their killers on the ground in Darfur. However, myself and another brilliant student who was co-founding Darfur Action Group with me, Chad Hazlett, were concerned that this wasn't a long-term answer. And we were racking our brains about what we could do to come up with a better answer. And we were rereading the book by our unofficial mentor, Samantha Power. And a quote by the late Senator Paul Simon kept flashing out. He had said, if every member of the House and Senate had received 100 letters from people back home saying that we have to do something about Rwanda when the crisis was first developing, then the response would have been different. Now, this is not a revolutionary idea. In fact, the entire theory of our democratic system is that if people care about something, they will make noise, and their representatives will respond to that noise. The trouble with the theory is it leaves out a very important detail. Any old noise won't do. Any old noise gets into the fear of sentimentality. What you need is noise that is connected to votes. And 9 times out of 10, that noise doesn't happen spontaneously. That noise takes organization. So I don't think, and this is my humble assessment of someone that's nowhere of the caliber of all the people that are speaking today, but I don't think that the real problem is a lack of information. I don't think that the real problem is that people don't care. I think the problem is that the care that they feel is not being translated into politically relevant noise. Noah Weisbord had said before about looking across past genocides and drawing the moral lessons, and I've been doing that. And when I look, what I see is that after every Rwanda or every situation of the former Yugoslavia, what we see is that a year later this analysis comes out, and the analysis says, why didn't we do anything? We didn't do anything because it wasn't a domestic political priority. What we then see are people wringing their hands and saying, never again. What we have yet to see are people who say, look, if the problem is that stopping genocide is not a political priority domestically, and if what we want is to see that genocide never happens again, well, for goodness sake, we'd better get down to the work of making sure that genocide becomes a domestic political priority. And that's the task that I'm intent on taking on with some other students who have been involved in the Darfur Action Group, and we're building something called the Genocide Intervention Network, which is to build a permanent anti-genocide constituency. Genocide is one of those very rare issues that cuts across ideological boundaries. Black, white, Christian, Muslim, democratic, conservative, it doesn't matter. If you're a human being, the chances are that you're against genocide. And yet, when we look at the moment, the communities that are being mobilized around this issue, it's either the lefty human rights community or it's the conservative religious community. And in the process, there's vast segments of middle America who are being left out. And even when people are being mobilized, it's around a discrete crisis. So what we're missing is that potential to tap into a permanent and sustained movement. When I look out at the landscape, I see politicians who care about being re-elected. They care about votes. And then I see some great organizations, the human rights NGOs, and they're pulling together great information and making good policy prescriptions to those politicians. Then over here, what we have are the thousands of Americans who go and see Hotel Rwanda, who care about stopping genocide. But what I don't see is a concerted and systematic organization to link those groups together. Until now, no organization has been able to approach a resistant congressperson and say, look, we have 4,586 dues-paying members in your district. They know what is going on in Darfur. They have heard what you could be doing to stop it. And they have paid money to see this genocide end. They'll be receiving a report card with your photograph on it, and it'll be telling them how you voted on this piece of upcoming legislation. Lest you think I'm anti-politicians, this is not only about a stick. It's also about giving them the carrot. The flip side of this coin is that we want to give those politicians that are out there working to change the political capital in order to do so. this is going to sound somewhat out of context, but the National Rifle Association has become a favorite topic of study for me. The other month, they managed to get an amendment into a federal highway bill that granted income tax exemptions to small firearms manufacturers. When it comes to genocide, we currently can't get support for the African Union peacekeepers in Darfur into a Darfur bill. What kind of world is this that we're living in when there's a smart, powerful, and strategic constituency out there to protect rifle owners and not to protect civilians from genocide? Unfortunately, Darfur is the first, but it will not be the last genocide of this century. And I believe that we are doing a disservice to ourselves and to the people who are dying in Darfur if we come away from this crisis wringing our hands, saying the words never again, and hoping for the best until next time. Putting the work into building a permanent anti-genocide constituency now, I believe is necessary to save lives in the future. In all previous instances of mass atrocity, the public has only recognized the gravity of the situation after thousands have already died. My vision is of a world where the genocide intervention network that we're building will ensure that next time the outcry occurs before it is too late. Thank you.